هستی.
Good morning. Welcome to worship. There are copies of the builder in back. We are trying to cut down on what we mail in an effort to save money. I know we have mailed some out this week to our homebound members, but feel free to pick up extra copies, hand them out to friends, neighbors, whomever. There are some in back, so please take those with you. That's really all the announcements that I have. Beth has an announcement.
You might notice at the back of your bulletin, there's an invitation at the very bottom. Salem members and friends are invited to a farewell brunch and a little program with Pastor Erica Cunningham on Sunday, February 20th, following worship services. And we're going to be in the lower auditorium. It offers us more space for social distancing. And we certainly hope that all of you will put it on your schedule and make a point.
I invite you to please rise as you are able. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who creates us, redeems us, and calls us by name. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you and your beloved children. We have turned our faces away from your glory when it did not appear as we expected. We have rejected your word when it made us confront ourselves. We have failed to show hospitality to those you called us to welcome. Accept our repentance for the things we have done and the things we have left undone. For the sake of Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us and lead us, that we may bathe in the glory of your Son born among us, and reflect your love for all creation. Rejoice in this good news. In Christ Jesus, your sins are forgiven. You are descendants of the Most High, adopted into the household of Christ, and inheritors of eternal life. Live as freed and forgiven children of God.
Holy, 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 holy.
Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Most holy God, the earth is filled with your glory, and before you, angels and saints stand in awe. Enlarge our vision to see your power at work in the world, and by your grace, make us heralds of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated.
First lesson is from Isaiah chapter 6. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting on a throne, high and lofty, and the hem of his robe filled the temple. Seraphs were in attendance above him. Each had six wings. With two they covered their faces, and with two they covered their feet, and with two they flew. And one called to another and said, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory." The pivots on the threshold shook at the voices of those who called, and the house filled with smoke. And I said, "Woe is me, I am lost, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips. Yet my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts." Then one of the seraphs flew to me, holding a live coal that had been taken from the altar with a pair of tongs. The seraph touched my mouth with it and said, "Now that this has touched your lips, your guilt has departed, and your sin is blotted out." Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, "Whom shall I send, and who will go for us?" And I said, "Here am I, send me." And he said, "Go and say to this people, keep listening, but do not comprehend. Keep looking, but do not understand. Make the mind of this people dull, and stop their ears, and shut their eyes, so that they may not look with their eyes, and listen with their ears, and comprehend with their minds, and turn and be healed." Then I said, "How long, O Lord?" And he said, "Until cities lie waste without inhabitant, and houses without people, the land is utterly desolate, until the Lord sends everyone far away, and vast is the emptiness in the midst of the land. Even if a tenth part remain in it, it will be burned again, like a terebinth or an oak, whose stump remains standing when it is felled. The holy seed is its stump." The word of the Lord. Psalm is number 138. I will give thanks to you, O Lord, with my whole heart. Before the gods, I will sing your praise.
I will bow down toward your holy temple and praise your name. You have such a steadfast love and faithfulness. For you have glorified your name and your word above all things.
When I called, you answered me. You increased my strength within me.
All the rulers of the earth perished in the Lord, and their burdens are no more.
They will sing of the ways of the Lord, that great is the glory of the Lord.
The Lord is high, yet cares for the lowly, perceiving the haughty from afar.
Though I walk in the midst of trouble, keep me safe. You stretch forth your hand against the fury of my enemies. Your right hand shall save me.
You will make your purpose for me, O Lord. Your steadfast love endures forever. Do not abandon the works of your hands.
Our second reading is from 1 Corinthians 15. Now I would remind you, brothers and sisters, of the good news that I proclaimed to you, which you in turn received, in which you also stand, through which you are being saved, if you hold firmly to the sins in accordance with the scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas and then to the 12. Then he appeared to more than 500 brothers and sisters at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have died. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles. Last of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared also to me. For I am the least of the apostles, unfit to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace toward me has not been in vain. On the contrary, I worked harder than any of them, though it was not I, but the grace of God that is with me. Whether then it was I or they, so we proclaim, and so you have come to believe. The word of the Lord.
Please rise as you are able. The Holy Gospel according to Luke. Once, while Jesus was standing beside the lake of Gennesaret, the crowd was pressing in on him to hear the word of the Lord. He saw two boats there at the shore of the lake. The fishermen had gone out of them and were washing their nets. He got into one of the boats, the one belonging to Simon, and asked him to put out a little way from the shore. Then he sat down and taught the crowds from the boat. When he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, "Put out into the deep water and let your nets down for a catch." Simon answered, "Master, we have worked all night long but have caught nothing. Yet, if you say so, I will let down the nets." When they had done this, they caught so many fish that their nets were beginning to break. So they signaled their partners in the other boat to come and help them. And they came and filled both boats, so that they began to sink. But when Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, "Go away from me, Lord, for I am a sinful man." For he and all who were with him were amazed at the catch of fish that they had taken. And so also were James and John, sons of Zebedee, who were partners with Simon. Then Jesus said to Simon, "Do not be afraid. From now on, you will be catching people." When they had brought their boats to shore, they left everything and followed him. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise
you, Lord. You may be seated. So the story goes that Mark Twain loved to go fishing, but he hated to catch fish. And the problem was that he would go fishing to relax, but catching fish ruined his relaxation, what with having to take them off the hook and then do something with it. So when he wanted to relax, he would just go out by the lake or the river and throw an empty line into the water, so that when people walked by, they would think that he was fishing and they wouldn't bother him. But I'm guessing that Simon and the others who were out fishing that morning were far from relaxed. They had fished all night and caught nothing. They were exhausted. Their nets were empty. And they needed fish for their livelihoods. How were they going to eat or feed their families? And now, along comes Jesus. And I'm guessing he was the last person they were expecting to see that morning. But as we see, This whole story is full of surprises and unexpected events. When Jesus shows up, he just climbs right into Simon's boat. He doesn't say hello. He doesn't even ask for permission first. He just climbs right in. But isn't that what Jesus does? He just shows up in our lives when we're least expecting him. He doesn't ask for permission first. He just climbs right in. So Jesus tells Simon to take the boat further out. Now, poor Simon. Here he had been up all night fishing with nothing to show for it. He was cleaning his nets and probably getting ready to go home and go back to bed. But he takes Jesus out anyway. And we don't really know why, but he just does what Jesus asks of him. And then Peter does something else unexpected. He lets down his nets. You know, those same ones he had just been cleaning and getting ready to put away. But did you notice that nothing is really different this time around when Peter goes out? He doesn't have different nets. Jesus doesn't take him to a secret fishing spot on the lake. There's no new technique or gimmick to what he does. Nothing is different from what they've been doing all night, except Jesus. Jesus spoke to them, and God's word always changes things, even when those hearing that word fall short or have a hard time believing it. And Peter doesn't know what to make of all this. Maybe he's exhausted. Maybe he's overwhelmed. Whatever's going on in his head, he falls to his knees and cries out, "Go away from me, Lord, for I am a sinful man." And Jesus' response to him, "Do not be afraid." Note that Jesus doesn't say, "You are forgiven," which seems a little odd given that Peter has just confessed to him. But it isn't forgiveness that Peter is seeking. Yes, Jesus does forgive him for his sin, but Jesus also gives so much more. In this case, Jesus brings comfort and encouragement. Nothing in this story goes how we expect it to. But isn't that how it always works with God? God is always doing the unexpected. God doesn't come to earth as a mighty king, but as a helpless baby. And God chooses the least expected people to carry out God's work. An unwed teenager, tax collectors, prostitutes, beggars, and immigrants. "Do not be afraid," Jesus says to Simon and James and John. "And do not be afraid," Jesus says to you. We don't know the future here at Salem. I know that I feel like I've been out fishing all night with nothing to show for it. And maybe you feel the same. We don't know where we're going, but we know the one who goes with us. God is always surprising us. Just like with the fishermen, Jesus just shows up in our lives. Jesus comes when we least expect and makes himself at home. He doesn't ask our permission first. He just shows up. And when Jesus shows up, amazing things happen. Our lives are overflowing with love and grace. Thanks be to God, we have a Savior who always guides our way. Amen.
Thank you.
council members to come forward. Let's gather. You'll face me to begin with, and then me. You get a turn in circles with it. These people have been elected by the congregation to positions of leadership. We give thanks for their willingness to serve. In baptism, we are welcomed into the body of Christ and sent to share in the mission of God. We rejoice now that these sisters and brothers will lead us in our common life and our mutual mission as a congregation. A reading from 1 Corinthians. There are varieties of gifts, but the same Spirit. And there are varieties of services, but the same Lord. And there are varieties of activities, but it is the same God who activates all of them in everyone. To each is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. You have been elected to positions of leadership and trust in this congregation. You are to see that the words and deeds of this household of faith bear witness to God, who gathers us into one together with the whole church. You are to seek to involve all members of this congregation in worship, learning, witness, service, and support, so that the mission of Christ is carried out in this congregation, in the wider church, in this community, and in the whole world. You are to be faithful to your specific area of serving, that the Spirit who empowers you may be glorified. You are to be examples of faith, active in love, fostering peace, harmony, and mutual understanding of this congregation. On behalf of your sisters and brothers in Christ, I ask you, will you accept and faithfully carry out the duties of the offices to which you have been elected? If so, please respond, I will, and I ask God to help me.
I will, and I ask God to help me.
I invite you to please face the congregation. People of God, I ask you, will you support these, your elected leaders, and will you share in the mutual ministry that Christ has given to all who are baptized? If so, please respond, we will, and we ask God to help us. Okay, now you face me again. I now declare you installed as officers and council members of this congregation. Almighty God bless you and direct your days and your deeds in peace, that you may be faithful servants of Christ. Amen. You may return to your places. And I invite the congregation to please rise. With the whole church, let us confess our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
The Spirit of the Lord is poured out upon us in abundance, so we are bold to pray for the church, the world, and all that God has made. Equip your church to proclaim the good news that we have first received, the forgiveness and grace shown to us through Jesus Christ. Send us out as apostles, sharing the hope of your salvation with a waiting world. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Holy are you, O God of hosts. Heaven and earth are filled with your glory. Reveal your splendor in fiery sunsets and in deep blue twilights. Teach us to recognize you in the beauty of our natural world. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Soften the hearts of rulers and governments that they perceive and tend to the needs of their people. Remove corruption and the impulse toward violence. Protect first responders and military personnel who risk their lives in the service of others. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Your steadfast love endures forever. Do not abandon those who look to you for hope and healing. Bless doctors, nurses, social workers, therapists, and all caregivers. Draw near to those who are scared, sick, or in pain, especially Larry, Sue, Woody, Alta, Joe, Jim, Carol, Susan, Shirley, and all others on our hearts and minds this day. God of grace, the disciples received help from partners as they brought in an abundant catch of fish. So strengthen this congregation's partnerships with community organizations and ministries. Multiply our shared efforts and bring joy to our relationships. God of grace, we give thanks for our ancestors in faith who boldly answered your call. By their example, give us courage to live in faith and to proclaim your mercy until the day that you gather us into your glory. God of grace, since we have such great hope in your promises, O God, we lift these and all our prayers to you in confidence and faith, through Jesus Christ, our Savior.
The peace of Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
Please share a socially distant sign of peace. Holy, mighty, and merciful Lord, heaven and earth are full of your glory. In great love you sent to us Jesus, your Son, who reached out to heal the sick and suffering, who preached good news to the poor, and who, on the cross, opened his arms to all. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering therefore his death, resurrection, and ascension, we await his coming in glory. Pour out upon us the spirit of your love, O Lord, and unite the wills of all who share this heavenly food the body and blood of Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated and partake of the bread and wine, the body of Christ given for you, and the blood of Christ shed for you. And I invite you to please rise as you are able. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Let us pray. Blessed Jesus, at this table you have been for us both host and meal. Now send us forth to extend our tables and to share your gifts, until that day when all feast together at your heavenly banquet. Amen. The God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that you may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit, through Christ Jesus, for whom we wait. Amen.
Christ, to come to us, we would just to pray.
into a weary world, share the good news.
Thanks.